We have discussed map projection and map scale. Now we'll briefly discuss some other important components of maps. Your book notes 8 map essentials. Not every map will have all 8 of these essentials, but in general these 8 components will make a map more effective and clear. See Figure 211 shown here as an example of a map that shows all 8 map essentials. First, the title. Titles briefly note a map's content and purpose, and it helps ensure that a map is not misused. Next, the map date. This map shows the date of publication. It would also be useful to have the date of the data collection. Just because a map was published on a certain date doesn't necessarily mean that the data was from that date as well. So some maps actually show publication dates and data collection dates. Next, a legend. This is important. It explains the colors and symbols used on the map. In some cases, common or intuitive colors or symbols may not be explained, for instance, blue for water. Next, map scale. Scales, as we know, show the relationship between the distance on the map and the distance in real life. There's 3 common types of scales: graphic, fractional, and verbal. And maps may have more than one type of scale. Generally, maps will also have some way of showing direction, often a little compass rose like that's shown here. Latitude-longitude lines can also help us get a sense of direction as well, because we know latitude lines run east-west and longitude lines run north-south. Next, every map should have some sort of system for finding location. In this case, they've used latitude and longitude, but other systems like alphanumeric or UTM may be used as well. Next, the data source. This is very important. You want to be able to assess the accuracy and validity of the data. Who collected the data? Can you trust the accuracy? If the data comes from a source you know to be biased, you'd have to be very careful when analyzing the map. And then lastly, projection type. Generally, this is only shown for small-scale maps where there may be significant distortion. You may not always see it on large-scale maps, which probably have less distortion. As you proceed through the course, look around at maps you see in your textbooks, classrooms, or on the internet. Do they include all these components? If not, would the map be improved by adding one of the missing components, or is it not necessary? On some maps, truly not all 8 essentials are necessary. Our next topic is isolines. Isolines are a very important tool for portraying information on maps. As you learned when you read your textbook, an isoline can be defined as a line that connects points of equal value. Notably, there are many different types of isolines. 4 of the most common types of isolines are listed below, and we will use all of these in our class. Read through them now. Contour lines, shown on the left here, connect points of equal elevation. Isohyets, shown on the right, connect points of equal precipitation. Isotherms, shown above, connect points of equal temperature. And isobars, shown below, connect points of equal pressure. In all cases, we are able to show an enormous amount of data visually in a way that makes it easy for the reader to understand. There are a few basic characteristics of isolines that will make them easier to understand and interpret. First of all, isolines are closed lines. They have no ends. View the map here, shown at the right. None of the isolines simply end. They're all closed loops. Second, isolines do not generally cross. Think about it. It's generally not possible for a particular point to simultaneously have 2 temperatures or 2 elevations. One rare exception would be for elevation, If there is a sheer cliff, at that point isolines might merge together, but that's the rare exception. In general, isolines do not cross. Third, the numerical distance between adjacent isolines is called the interval. The difference between two adjacent contour lines we refer to as the contour interval. Generally, the interval will remain constant throughout the map. Fourth, if isolines are spaced closely together, that means there's a steep gradient. Closely spaced contour lines depict a steep hill. Closely spaced isotherms would depict a region of rapidly changing temperature from one place to another. Fifth, if isolines are spaced far apart, there's a gradual gradient. So contour lines spaced far apart would depict a very gradual slope. Isolines are very useful for map interpretation. See if you can answer the following questions based on the maps shown. For each question, I'm going to give the answer soon after the question, so consider pausing the video so that you can answer the question on your own. First, on the map that uses isotherms, do you think this map depicts average January temperatures or average July temperatures, and why? Second, on the same map, what factor seems to play a major role in determining temperature? Third, on the isobar map, are high pressure cells more common over oceans or land in January? Fourth, on the same map, does wind generally flow from high pressure to low pressure, or from low pressure to high pressure? Fifth, on the isohyet map, does latitude affect annual rainfall? On the same map, what latitude seems to have a large number of the world's deserts? Seventh, on the contour map, which side of Tabor Hill is steeper, the east side or the west side? And lastly, which is taller, Katy Hill or Tabor Hill? Hopefully you were able to answer a lot of these questions by interpreting isolines. Lastly, let's see how to construct an isoline map. The data shown here could be about anything, but hypothetically, let's say it's a bunch of elevation data that was obtained out in the field or through remote sensing. The first thing to do is to look at your map and see what the range of data that you have is, and where the high points are and where the low points are. You can see some of the lower values down to 108 here, some of the higher values are over here. So first we have to determine what sort of contour interval we're going to use on this map. For this data, perhaps every 10 feet would be a suitable contour interval. So let's start by first trying perhaps to draw the 140-foot contour line. I don't see any values exactly for 140, but between 137 feet above sea level and 142 feet above sea level, if I was walking along that, at some point I would hit 140. There's a 5-foot elevation difference here, and 3 feet away from 137, I would hit 140. So I could put a light pencil mark there to mark that. Similarly, between 128 and 142 feet above sea level, 140 must exist in there as well. There's a 14-foot elevation gain, but it's only 2 feet from 142, so 1/7 of the way across right here would be 140, so I could put a light pencil mark there. And you would continue to do the same thing between any two points that would have 140 between them. Then you would draw a smooth line to connect those points, and you'd have your 140-foot contour line, which I should have labeled down here, and I didn't do that. Next, you do the same thing for 150 feet, and 160 feet, and 170 feet, until you have all the different contour lines labeled. It's now very easy for the user to get a lot of data from just a quick glance at this map. They can find places that it would be very steep to go up the hill, where the contour lines are spaced close together. They could find places that it would be easier to walk up the hill, where the contour lines are spaced further apart. For elevation data, we don't usually shade the map in this manner. But for other types of data, maybe for temperature or rainfall, oftentimes we also shade these isoline maps. As noted previously, we'll be using maps that have isolines on them throughout the course. So I encourage you to practice analyzing these types of maps.